Good afternoon. Welcome, everybody. And on behalf of Calvin College Sexuality Series and the college, welcome to this afternoon's lecture by Dr. Wesley Hill, titled Between Presumption and Despair, Practicing the Virtue of Hope as a Celibate Gay Christian. My name is Julia Smith, and I direct the Sexuality Series programming here on campus. And thank you to everybody that took the time to come here this afternoon. I would also like to thank our co-sponsors, who are listed on one of the slides here, for your support for this event. And thank you also to our moderator, who will be Dr. Corinne Marg of the Meter Center and the History Department. I would also like to give my personal thanks to Wesley Hill for traveling to be with us on campus for these 2 days. It really is a blessing for us to have you, Wesley. Some people may wonder why we have events about homosexuality at Calvin College. We are holding these events for many good reasons. But one of the primary reasons is because we love our students. And these are topics that are of very great importance to many of our students, both gay and straight. Welcome, please come in, find yourselves a seat. Today's events and those next Tuesday with Justin Lee, who's the director of the Gay Christian Network, are part of a much larger conversation that has been going on at Calvin for several years. We are still learning how to have this conversation, but it is intentional and evolving. And today, we want to recognize that we welcome a diverse audience of gay, straight, lesbian, bisexual, transgender, queer people. We are also students, staff, faculty members, community members, parents, friends, alums, whoever you are, and whatever point you are at in this conversation about homosexuality, we hope that you find Calvin College to be a place of respect and grace. As the College of the Christian Reformed Church, Calvin holds to the position of the CRC on human sexuality, articulated in 1973 and in 2002. Two key aspects of these reports are that same-sex orientation is not sinful, and that sex is intended by God for marriage between a woman and a man. I believe we do not choose to be gay, bisexual, lesbian, transgender, or straight. But what we can choose is to love one another by God's grace and by His Holy Spirit, because we are all image bearers of God and saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. We still have plenty of work to do as a college, but we are getting better. And these conversations, Wesley Hill's work, the work of Justin Lee, directly help us in this dialogue. I hope many of you will be able to come back and join us tonight for Dr. Hill's second talk at 7 p.m. also in this room, when he will be talking to us about spiritual friendship from a gay Christian perspective. And for Calvin students, I would especially like to highlight the book clubs that we're offering. These will be running for 4 weeks, starting either next week or the week after, depending on the individual group. And there are some groups that will be reading and studying Dr. Hill's book, Washed and Waiting, and other groups that will be reading and studying Justin Lee's book, Torn. Please read your student news and sign up online for those groups. Finally, a few words about logistics for this afternoon. We will have question and answer time following Wesley's talk. So please feel free to fill out the question card that you received on the way in. at any point during the talk, if you have a question, just write that down. And after Wesley's talk is done, you can pass the cards along the rows, and there are some students here wearing bright orange t-shirts that say, "You are loved." And they will be standing at the sides to collect the questions and bring them forward for our moderator to ask Wesley. And the second card that you received is our evaluation. It's so helpful if people can fill that out, and you can leave that in the basket as you leave. After the talk, Wesley will be available in the lobby area for book signing or just to meet you. We have a book table out there, and there will be refreshments which will materialize by the end of this session. So now I would like to invite junior student who is majoring in business, Titus Hankins, to lead us in prayer. Thank you.
Whoa. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for your unending love and mercy you display on us every day of our lives. We thank you for waking us up today, keeping us healthy, and continuing to bless us despite the times when we do not put you first in our lives. We thank you for bringing Wesley here to engage us in a topic that we do not hear of very often. Open our hearts, our minds, and our ears, God, so we can listen to what he has to say and use what he teaches us in our daily lives. We understand that the words said today may be hard to hear for some, but we are sure everyone will find useful points in what Wesley has to say. Again, God, we thank you for the blessing to live in a nation and time where we can speak freely about such topics without fear. Equip our hearts and our minds, God. In your name we pray. Amen.
Well, good afternoon. As Julia said, my name is Karen Mogg, and I am a professor in the history department here at Calvin and the director of the Meter Center for Calvin Studies. I was very glad to be asked to be moderator for this afternoon's session because I believe we need to discuss these important and sensitive topics, and we need to model how to do these discussions well. And it's something I value that Calvin College puts itself forward as a place to do discussions of what are sometimes hard topics and do these discussions well. I'm delighted to introduce to you today's speaker, Dr. Wesley Hill. Dr. Hill is Assistant Professor of New Testament at Trinity School for Ministry in Pittsburgh. He received his BA from Wheaton College and his MA and PhD in theology from Durham University in England. Dr. Hill is the author of Washed and Waiting, Reflections on Christian Faithfulness and Homosexuality, and he is currently working on a book on spiritual friendship. He blogs at spiritualfriendship.org. His presentation to us this afternoon is titled Between Presumption and Despair, Practicing the Virtue of Hope as a Celibate Gay Christian. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Hill.
Well, thank you very much for that very kind introduction, and thanks to Julia and the other staff and students I've met for such a warm welcome. It's really been a delight to be here so far. Your campus is beautiful. Everyone has been very warmly welcoming and friendly, and I feel already very blessed and grateful for the time that I've had here. So if it's all right, I would like to pray once more before we start and then share with you what I have to say. Gracious God, we do thank you for the words we've already heard, that you are a God of love and that you enfold each of us in your embrace. I pray now for the illumination of your spirit and that you will allow us to participate in a grace-filled conversation with one another. We ask all this in the name of Christ. Amen. Well, as you've heard, my theme for today is the theme of hope. What does hope look like, particularly for those of us who are sexual minorities? And this is going to be quite a personal talk. I'm going to share with you my story of finding hope, which will, of course, look different than the way many of you have found hope. And I hope that at the end of the time, when we have opportunity for questions and answers and discussion, that some of those differences might arise. And I was very heartened by what you said, Julia, about this is an ongoing conversation for this campus. And I want to say it's an ongoing conversation for me. There are many times where I'm not quite sure I've understood traditional Christianity's perspective on sexual ethics or what flourishing looks like for me. And so I'm eager to engage with you and to learn from you as well. So between presumption and despair, I want to start off by thinking for a few minutes about how all of us who have been baptized, all of us who name the name of Christ, are caught up in a kind of future-oriented existence as believers. For those of us who've been baptized, we have been buried with Christ, St. Paul tells us, and we've been raised to new life. So we take our bearings from a past set of events, the events of Good Friday and Easter Sunday and Pentecost, and our participation in those events as baptized believers. And those events don't remain in the past. They impel us or propel us forward into the future. We find ourselves caught up in the events of Christ saving life and death and then thrown forward to move toward the future that he's opened up for us through his resurrection. So we find ourselves living in a kind of tension and looking toward a future that we don't yet see. Here's the way the Apostle Paul puts it in Romans chapter 8. He says, "For in hope we were saved." So there's the past tense salvation that we have been made participants in, but it's a salvation that points us toward a future that we don't yet see. Now, hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. We're waiting for something that is not yet tangible in our experience. So the question that I want to explore today, and in a sense I want to invite you into my asking of that question in my personal life, is what does it look like to live that kind of future-oriented existence as a Christian if you're a sexual minority, particularly in my case if you're gay? What does it look like for a gay Christian to experience the hope that the gospel offers? Theologian Oliver O'Donovan asked it this way: how can gay experience be clothed in an appropriate pattern of life for the service of God and discipleship of Christ? If we find ourselves to be a gay or lesbian, what then does it look like to bring that into the healing light of the gospel and find the hope that the gospel gives applicable to our particular set of questions and concerns? That's what I want to talk about. What does living in hope look like for us who are gay or lesbian? And what you find, as I found, as soon as I started asking these questions, as soon as I started allowing myself to engage with these questions and bring them to others in the body of Christ, is you find a confusing, at times confusing, diversity of answers in the church. There are different ways that people think about what it means to live in hope as a gay Christian. I just want to share a couple of these with you and then talk about how my story doesn't fit exactly with these answers. The first answer, I think, that we often hear about how to live in hope as a gay Christian is hope takes the form of a diminishment of our same-sex attractions. There is hope, we're often told, and that hope comes to us in the form that we don't have to remain gay or lesbian. Here's a quote, which, as soon as you start Googling things like change and homosexuality, this is the kind of thing that you find. This is from a very well-known Christian organization who promotes this kind of answer to the question of hope for us. "Regarding sexual orientation change, we will continue to uphold change as a reasonable goal for Christians with same-sex attraction who are earnestly seeking God and who are willing to do the hard work of resolving their gender disintegration through Christ and his healing community." We realize, this ministry goes on, that not all will graduate into a state of readiness for marriage. However, that should not preclude anyone from seeking full sexual restoration. And of course, in this perspective, that's the end of the quote. Often this takes the form of going back into the past and unearthing what are the roots of your same-sex attraction and embracing a certain kind of narrative about what those roots are. Justin Lee will talk much more in depth about this next week when he gives a lecture on ex-gay ministries and the paradigm that is often associated with those ministries. In this understanding, hope takes the form of a change in present circumstances, particularly the circumstances of same-sex attraction, and the possibility of marriage and family. And I'll just say, and I'll come back to this in a moment, celibacy often plays a very diminished role in this understanding of hope for gay Christians. Marriage and family is the main event. That's one answer to the question of where we might find hope. A very different answer is that we gay Christians, as we bring our lives into the light of the gospel, we may find hope in the form of a same-sex marriage. This is the perspective of many in the church, and again, you don't have to search very far to find articulate ways of speaking about this hope. I'm just going to share a couple with you. This is from the theologian Eugene Rogers, who I've found a lot of stimulation from as I've engaged with his writing. He writes this in his book, Sexuality and the Christian Body. He says, marriage is a bodily practice through which God enters the soul and disarms it with delight, lightening the load of impediments to love as it, embodied, hurries forward to something more and better for the body to mean. So in this understanding of hope for the gay Christian, hope is God is offering to take your desires, which may be troubling to you or confusing to you, and in a sense, honor them, sanctify them in the form of marriage. Here's how Rogers puts it in another place. He says, the vows, the marriage vows do this, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, till death do us part. Those ascetic vows, which Russian theologians compare to the vows of monastics, commit the couple to carry forward the solidarity of God and God's people. Marriage makes a school for virtue, where God prepares the couple for life with himself by binding them for life to each other. Marriage, in this view, is for sanctification, a means by which God can bring a couple to himself by turning their limits to their good. And here's his final sentence. And no conservative I know has seriously argued that same-sex couples need sanctification any less than opposite-sex couples do. So in this understanding of hope, again, very different from the earlier one that we looked at, hope takes the kind of concrete specificity. Hope is found in the possibility that my desires, which are raising lots of questions for me as a Christian, can be channeled and sanctified and given shape in Christian marriage. So Rogers, again, he concludes. He says, the questions for both sides of our current debate in the church is this. By what sort of sacramental practices can the church best teach gay and lesbian Christians to see themselves as occasions of joy, that God desires them as if they were God? And he's echoing Rowan Williams there about how the story of grace, the story of God's grace in Christ, is about teaching us that we are desired by God as if we were God. In our union with Christ, God looks at us through Christ and therefore sees his beloved. And so we are delighted in by God. And so I think Roger's question is a good one. By what sort of practices will the church best teach those of us who identify as gay or lesbian that we are indeed enfolded in the embrace of God's love? Well, what I'd like to share with you now for the minutes we have left, and then we'll move into a time of discussion, is why I feel that my story doesn't allow me to locate my hope in either of those options as I've just presented them. Those are two of the main answers that I heard as I began to open up the story of my sexuality to trusted friends, trusted pastors, trusted counselors in my life. When I was first beginning my journey of exploring my sexuality and what it meant for my faith, I was filled with questions. I had grown up in a quite a sheltered environment. I didn't know many, or in fact any, other gay or lesbian people that I knew of. And it wasn't until I went to college that I began to realize, if I want to grow in Christ, if I want to journey on with Christ, this can't be my reality. I can't be trying to cope with my sexuality by turning a blind eye to it and hoping that with enough ignoring, it will just simply disappear, or something will click and it will go away. I realized that ignoring is not the path to redeeming. Ignoring something is not the way to find and experience God's healing grace in the midst of it. And so when I was at your point in life, I decided that my philosophy professor would be the first person I told about my sexuality. And I began a process of bringing my questions to my faith rather than attempting to keep my faith and my questions about my sexuality separate and hope that the questions would simply go away and I could go on in faith without ever having to grapple with this kind of confusion. And so, of course, I began a search, and I encountered both those answers about where to find hope that I just shared with you. And with regard to the first one, hope in the form of diminished same-sex attractions, what I found difficult as I began to engage seriously with that answer is that I felt that I was being asked to narrate my story, to narrate the origins of my same-sex attractions in a way that didn't ring true for me. I was being asked to accept a certain kind of story about why I was gay that had to do with my father, who it was assumed was distant, and a certain story about my mother and my relationship with her. And the more I began to engage with this and to try to honestly, prayerfully consider this, I felt that it didn't illuminate the particulars of my life in a way that I had hoped it would. I also became discouraged about what I encountered in terms of the sweeping universal scope of the promises for change. I was told that the narrative that I was asked to embrace was a narrative that fit everyone with same-sex attraction. And when I began to push back on that, I began to bump up against what I felt was the confining nature of the kind of universal story, the universal expectation that with enough therapy or enough honesty or enough surrender, that change really is possible for everyone. And so I began to doubt that my hope could be found in that answer, the hope of a kind of diminishment of same-sex attraction so that heterosexual marriage would become a viable possibility for me. But at the same time I was grappling with that question, I also found myself grappling with the same-sex marriage question and wondering, could my hope be found in that narrative? And what I found is that the church that I belonged to and the pastors who were speaking into my life were saying things that I found persuasive. They were talking about how there is a biblical story of sexuality in which I can locate my particular story of sexuality. And this biblical meta-narrative includes the creation of male and female as the image bearers of God. But it doesn't stop there. It includes a theology of redemption, so that when Jesus comes and announces the kingdom of God in Matthew 19, he doesn't set aside the teaching of Genesis 1 and 2. He reaffirms it. He quotes Genesis 2 when he's asked about marriage in Matthew 19. So I found myself grappling with a biblical meta-narrative that didn't seem to allow me to find hope in the same-sex marriage option in the way that I would have liked. I felt that my calling to same-sex marriage would have to be based not on my reading of Scripture, but on my reading of my own interior sense of what my sexuality was asking me to do and to be in the world. And so I felt that I also had to reluctantly close the door on that version of hope. And so you can imagine, here I am, a young man wanting to journey on with Christ, wanting to grow in my faith in Christ, and finding myself asking yet again, what does hope look like for me? What does it look like to inhabit this Christian story as a gay Christian in a way that doesn't simply lead to despair? a way that doesn't simply lead to ongoing confusion, an ongoing sense of shame, which had prevented me for so long from sharing the story of my sexuality with anyone. What did hope look like for me? And in the time we have left, we've got a few minutes left before the Q&A, I want to share with you three aspects of the hope that I eventually came to as a gay Christian. Three pillars or constitutive features or something like that of the hope that I came to. And I'll just dive right into the first one and then spend a bit of time on the later two. What I found, I'll just give you my kind of the rest of my talk in a sentence. So if you wanna zone out after this, you will have gotten the thesis of the talk. What I came to is that the hope that God was calling me to in the gospel was hope that came in the form of discerning a positive call to love as a celibate person. The hope that I came to was hope in the form of a positive call to love, toward love, precisely in my celibacy. And now I want to share with you three aspects of that hope and how that plays itself out in my life. And then I'll look forward to conversation about it afterwards. The first aspect, the hope that I'm seeking to practice more fully day by day as a gay Christian, takes the form first of naming the tension that I inhabit. Naming the tension. And the tension for me is that I don't feel in any way that my same-sex attraction has diminished or gone away. Nor, if I'm honest, do I feel that it's likely to go away anytime soon. But on the other hand, I also don't feel any greater sense of freedom to pursue same-sex marriage than I did several years ago when I was first beginning to engage with these questions. My grappling with the biblical text, my reading of the church fathers, my wrestling with the tradition has led to a deepening conviction on that point. So if I'm going to have hope, the first thing I've realized I have to do is just name that tension and be honest with myself about what kind of tension it is that I inhabit. And the tension for me is the tension of not experiencing full healing in the way that that's often described in a kind of reparative therapy narrative, nor is it hope in the form of experiencing freedom to pursue same-sex marriage. That's my tension. That's the starting point for thinking about hope for me, is just being honest with myself about what the tension is, what the two poles are that feel as though they're pulling me in directions I don't always want to go. Secondly, my hope that I've come to is based on believing that my story is unfinished, and thus choosing to inhabit rather than to escape a life of tension. Let me say that one more time. The hope that I have is based on believing that my story is unfinished, and thus I'm choosing to inhabit rather than to try to escape a life of tension. Joseph Pieper wrote a wonderful little book talking about Thomas Aquinas on hope. And Pieper's little book is just called On Hope. And it's very brief. You could read it in a couple of hours. But I have found so much encouragement from this little book. And I want to read to you a quote from this. Pieper writes that hope is a virtue that's poised between the two poles of presumption and despair. The concept of the status viatori is one of the basic concepts of every Christian rule of life. To be a viator means one who is on the way. The status viatori, then, is the condition or the state of being on the way. Its proper antonym is the status comprehensori, one who has comprehended, encompassed, arrived, is no longer a viator, but a comprehensor. And Pieper says that according to Aquinas, none of us this side of the eschaton, this side of the beatific vision, none of us comprehend everything. All of us are pilgrims on the way. And so what we're called to reject as Christians are any options that would tempt us into believing the lie that our story is finished, and that we no longer need to inhabit attention. Presumption is one of the ways that we humans are prone to assume that the story is finished. Presumption says that there is no state of being on the way. There is no reason to be a pilgrim anymore because we've already arrived. That's the sin of presumption. And it's a sin that closes a story rather than keeps a story open. It's a story that closes a pilgrimage rather than inciting a pilgrimage or leading someone to continue a pilgrimage. But equally, on the other side, despair is also a sin that closes down our sense of inhabiting attention or belonging to an ongoing story. Despair rejects the state of being on the way by assuming that the end has already come and that it is bleak. So true Christian hope is based on the recognition that neither presumption nor despair can do justice to the fact that God's story for each of us is yet unfinished until the coming of Christ and the day of resurrection. So hope, for me, in light of what Pieper's written here, is believing that my story is unfinished and thus making the conscious choice day after day not to try to wriggle out from tension, not to treat the Christian life as something that is about the escape from tension, but rather treating hope as something that leads me to more fully recognize, name, and inhabit attention that may, after all, turn out to be for my greater good. So thirdly, my hope is based on recognizing that wayfarers, viators, those who are on the way, those who have not yet arrived, are called to discover the grace of a vocation in the midst of the tension that they experience. Let me say that one more time. Thirdly, my hope is based on recognizing that wayfarers, those who have not yet arrived, are called to discover the grace of a vocation in the midst of the tension that they experience. And here I'm thinking primarily of the Apostle Paul, and I'm thinking of a couple different places. I'm thinking first of the end of his second epistle to the Corinthians. Very famous passage in chapter 12 where he writes about this thorn in the flesh. And he uses the biblical idiom of three times. Three times, meaning very intensely, frequently, I pled with the Lord that this thorn would be taken away from me. I asked that I would be able to escape this life of tension that I'm feeling. I asked that I would be able to break free from this experience of pain. And the answer came to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect. And I remember the first time I noticed this preposition. It was a kind of aha moment for me. Power is made perfect in weakness. I would rather it read, power is made perfect out of weakness. Power is made perfect by being delivered from the condition of weakness. But as Paul he's gone to great lengths to explain earlier in the letter, that life of weakness, that's a very important word in the second epistle to the Corinthians. And it's a word that Paul views as what unites him to the sufferings of Christ. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, he is someone who views himself as participating in the dying of Jesus. His bodily ailments, his weakness, his personal presentation to the Corinthians, which causes him so much difficulty with them because they're wanting a much more powerful personality. That very weakness is the way in which he portrays Christ crucified to the Corinthians, and the way that he also imparts or shares the risen life of Christ with the Corinthians, so that the dying of Jesus and the rising of Jesus are born anew in the Corinthian community. Another place I'm thinking of is Romans chapter 8, which I mentioned earlier, which is the passage where Paul links, very interestingly, he links the groaning of creation. He says creation itself is groaning, waiting for the day when it will be set free from its bondage to decay. He's picturing the inanimate creation, the world itself, as being imprisoned and yearning for its freedom. And he links that groaning with the groaning that believers experience as those who have the Spirit and are sharing in the groaning of creation, which he then links, thirdly, to the groaning of the Spirit, the indwelling Spirit, on our behalf. And this image of groaning is not something that Paul diminishes as the chapter goes on. I mean, he of course finishes with a flourish, doesn't he? The love of God is something that, from which no one will ever be able to separate us. So there's great triumph here, but it's not a triumph that's born out of the escape from tension. It's a triumph that comes as he wills to share in the groaning of creation, as he willingly takes on himself through the Spirit the vocation of bearing the pain of the world and sharing in that pain as he ministers Christ to the nations. And I remember what a powerful thing it was for me when I first read Richard Hayes's commentary on this passage. This is a very short quote, but this was profound for me. Hayes writes, "Anyone who does not recognize this," and by this he means Paul's description of groaning, "anyone who does not recognize this as a description of authentic Christian existence has never struggled seriously with the imperatives of the gospel, which challenge and frustrate our natural impulses in countless ways." Let me read that one more time. Writing about Romans 8, "Anyone who does not recognize this," what Paul writes, "as a description of authentic Christian existence has never struggled seriously with the imperatives of the gospel, which challenge and frustrate our natural impulses in countless ways." In other words, hope for Paul takes the form of discovering that he's called to the vocation of apostleship precisely in and through his weakness. He's given a calling that he discovers only by choosing to name and sit with his weakness rather than leaving it behind. And what he finds is that it's a vocation to be the apostle to the nations. It's a vocation to bear the suffering of Christ to the Corinthians. And it's a vocation not only to leave it in Corinth, but to take it all the way around to Illyricum, as he says in Romans 15. He's called to bear this dying of Jesus in his own bodily weakness on behalf of the Gentiles. There's a fascinating letter from C.S. Lewis in the book A Severe Mercy, which some of you will know. Those of you who haven't read that book, I just so highly recommend it. It's the story of Sheldon Van Auken and his wife who travel to Britain for further study at Oxford as very happy pagans, as they describe themselves. And when they get there, totally unexpectedly, they encounter Christ and their lives are changed. And what they find is that they're propelled into this ministry of leading a Bible study at Oxford. And what they find is that there are people with, I can't remember the terms that he uses there. Probably he uses the term homosexual. There are some homosexual students who turn up for this Bible study. And Sheldon Van Auken, being a new Christian, not knowing, you know, what do Christians think about sex and marriage and sexuality, he doesn't know. Much like me, trying to figure out what form does hope take in my life. And so he writes to C.S. Lewis, who by that point has become a friend. And he says, you know, this is the situation in this Bible study that my wife and I are leading. What should I say to these students who are asking me for guidance about how to submit this aspect of their lives to the Lordship of Jesus? And Lewis writes back a long letter, but and much of it is problematic. I'm not happy with all the aspects of this letter. If you go and Google it later, but here's a paragraph from the letter that continues to provoke me as I think about it. Lewis writes to Van Auken, "Our speculations on the cause of homosexuality are not what matters, and we must be content with ignorance." How different that is from much of the conversation that's happened in evangelical Christianity over the past several decades. Lewis goes on, "The disciples were not told why, in terms of efficient cause, the man was born blind in John's Gospel, chapter 9. Only the final cause, that the works of God should be made manifest in him. This suggests that in homosexuality, as in every other tribulation, those works can be made manifest. I.e., Lewis writes, every disability," and he's calling homosexuality a disability here, which I realize is not something all of us would share. He says, every disability conceals a vocation, if only we can find it, which will turn the necessity to glorious gain. Whether or not you're comfortable talking about your sexuality as a kind of weakness or disability, as I've been implying here, or as Lewis says here, this idea that the things in our lives that cause us pain, the things in our lives that cause us confusion, may in fact be hiding from us a calling, a vocation, a calling toward something, a pull, not simply telling us to say no to something, but a positive push toward something. That was a new thought for me when I encountered this letter from Lewis. That hope for me might not simply take the form of sort of trying to be celibate in a kind of willpower-driven way. But celibacy for me, as I understand my life in light of the biblical meta-narrative of sexuality, might involve just as much or even more a positive call towards something, a vocation, that my sense of my sexuality is something that involves me in desires that are not the way God intends the world to be. That might not simply be the end of the story, but it might be concealing from me a positive calling that I'm called to embrace and live into and practice and inhabit more fully. That was a liberating thought for me. And later tonight, when I talk about spiritual friendship, I'm going to talk much more in depth about this, about how I understand my life as a celibate gay Christian as a positive calling to friendship, a positive calling to same-sex love as a celibate person. This was a kind of liberating thought for me, encountering Lewis. So let me just say once more, as we move toward time for us to have discussion, I want to just briefly restate the three ways that I found hope. And then I want to maybe just take a moment for us to reflect, and then I'll say a prayer, and then we can move toward some discussion of these matters. Hope for me takes the form of discerning a positive call to love as a celibate gay Christian. The hope that I'm seeking to practice more fully takes the form of naming the tension that I inhabit. Secondly, my hope is based on believing that my story is unfinished and thus choosing to inhabit rather than to escape a life of tension. And thirdly, my hope is based on recognizing that wayfarers, those who have not yet arrived, are called to discover the grace of a vocation in the midst of the tension that they experience. I hope, by the way, that we can all begin to recognize ourselves in this kind of description. Whether we're gay or straight, I think one of the challenges for us, and maybe one of the challenges for you as a campus, in having conversations about gay sexuality and straight sexuality, is that it can become difficult for us to look for ways in which we as fellow Christians are in solidarity with one another, whatever form our obedience to Christ is taking. So I think the identity labels can be very helpful insofar as they allow us to name the specifics of our story and to talk about the particular ways in which my questions look different from your questions. But insofar as those labels divide us and prevent us from recognizing a more profound solidarity in light of the gospel, I think perhaps our call is to hold those identities loosely and find our solidarity in embracing the shared hope of the gospel that comes to us as we're buried with Christ in baptism and raised to new life with Christ as we join him on the pilgrim road looking for the city that's to come. I wonder if we could just take a moment of quiet, and then in a moment I'll say a prayer. And then we can move into some conversation with one another around these topics. Gracious God, I pray now that you would remind us that there really is hope for every one of us here. There's hope for me. There's hope for every student, every faculty member, every staff member, every guest who's here. and that as we reach out for you to take hold of that hope, we find that you have already been reaching out to us. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Thank you.
While Wesley and I get settled, we'll pass questions down the aisle, so look for someone in an orange t-shirt to take your question cards from you. I know some people may have to leave. If you do have to leave, if you can make your way out now, that might be a good chance. I don't want you to leave, but if you have to leave. All right. And if anybody needs a seventh inning stretch in the meantime, feel free to do that too. So thank you so much for your presentation. It's been very, very good to have this, and I know a number of people are also looking forward to tonight as well. I wanted to start out with a question, and as I was listening to you and listening to your description of these two options, I was wondering why, with the first option, there isn't more emphasis on celibacy as a possibility. In other words, why does it move sort of immediately towards heterosexual marriage as the source of hope?
It's a great question. Part of me wants to say that the reason is, and I can't really offer you much concrete evidence for this, but part of me wants to view it as owing to the fact that so much of evangelical Christianity in particular has spent a lot of time zeroing in on the nuclear family as the locus in which to find lasting love, real love of all kinds, and a kind of eclipse at the same time of other forms of love. So before it's a problem with the question of homosexuality, I think we're dealing with a much bigger question of why is heterosexual marriage simply in the heterosexual community presented so often as a kind of be-all and end-all of human fulfillment and flourishing. So I'm tempted to say, a big part of the reason the gay community find them, the gay Christian community find themselves saying, our hope has to take the form of heterosexual marriage, is that we've been told often that is where hope is to be found, that is where flourishing is to be found. And so if we can't have that, then we can't have hope at all. I think maybe a more complicated question is why is it that celibacy is only viewed as something to hold out and emphasize if it can be a totally free choice that is one equal option that you could choose along with another option that is equally available to you. In other words, I think the first option would say, we can diminish your same-sex attractions, not so that you automatically have to get married, but if your choice of celibacy is going to be what it ought to be, you should have the option of marriage available to you. That should be on the table. So we want to diminish your same-sex attractions to the point where marriage, heterosexual marriage, really is a viable option, so that celibacy can then be a kind of unconstrained choice. It can be something that is freely entered into, rather than something you find yourself having to enter into.
Pushed into.
Exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
I can see that.
Yeah.
All right. Let's delve into the questions. What steps do you suggest we should take to heal those of us hurting from the stigma and exclusion already experienced? And this is from an alum.
Yeah. I guess I find that the best way that I know of to engage questions like that is to begin to talk about my own experience. I'm someone who grew up in a church culture, in a national culture that I did not feel was hospitable to me as someone who was wrestling with very serious questions about my sexuality. I grew up in a very loving two-parent family. I mean, my parents are I love them dearly, and I think they love me dearly. But somehow I absorbed, I mean, even at a very young age, I first started realizing gosh, I'm exclusively attracted to other guys, you know, when I was 13, 14 years old. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't anything my parents said, I don't think, nothing that I can distinctly remember, but somehow I absorbed the notion that I ought not talk about this.
Right.
This is something to keep under wraps. I mean, I can remember silently thinking to myself, I really hope that I'll be able to take this to the grave.
Right.
You know, that I'll no one will ever have to know about this. And I think I pinned a lot of hope on, you know, I'll go away to college, and don't a lot of people meet their spouses in college? Surely I'll meet, you mm-hmm. know, the right girl, and I'll have a spouse, and this will all just go away, and I won't have to deal with this anymore. So I guess the first thing I'd want to say in response to that question is, I feel like I have at least some taste of what that kind of oppressive sense of shame mm-hmm. is all about, and that sense of being so different that you really are not free to talk about that. You're not free to bring that to your pastor or your parents or your siblings. And I think it was profoundly healing for me when I went to my Christian college professor there was a lot of anxiety about that, wondering how is he going to respond. And his first thing that he wanted to say to me was, God loves you. Mm-hmm. Wherever you end up on this, I mean, I remember him even saying to me one time, you know, wherever you end up theologically, I am going to love you. That was very,
very
healing,
powerful.
Very powerful. And he also gave me the gift, which we don't often give one another in Christian community, the gift of not being shocked. Mm-hmm. I remember Francis Schaeffer said one time that Christians should never have the reaction designated by the term shocked. That's a wonderful statement. And what he meant is that we have a story, a meta-narrative that we inhabit that is so capacious, that is so big, that it allows us to grapple with any question under the sun. We don't have a religion that encourages us to turn a blind eye to difficult questions. Mm-hmm. And so he gave me I think just by his tenderness and by his acknowledgement of his own confusion. I mean, he was someone who spoke honestly about his own, you know, mental anxiety and difficulties. And I think his willingness to open up that created a safe environment for me to talk about my very different kinds of anxieties.
Yep.
So I suppose we could have another conversation about institutionally, what might it look like to be a safer place? What might it look like to experience healing as an institution? But I find myself, you know, thinking in the first instance,
sure,
more personally about,
sure,
what it looked like for me.
All right, let's try another one. Do you think celibacy is a rare, special calling, or is it more common than we think?
That's very interesting. I suppose that gets back to a little bit of what I was saying earlier about celibacy. I mean, one of the things that intrigues me about when Jesus talks about eunuchs, he uses this, I think he's using it metaphorically in at least a couple of the instances in Matthew 19. He has the bit on divorce at the beginning of Matthew 19, and then the disciples say, you know, if what you're saying about divorce is true, maybe none of us should get married. And then he says, well, I actually have a very positive view of eunuchs. Mm-hmm. And he goes on to talk about eunuchs. And he talks about there are eunuchs, you know, who have been made eunuchs by men. Mm-hmm. So that's the kind of, you know we think about the eunuch that's been made a eunuch by men so that he can serve in the king's harem without,
sure,
you know, fear or whatever. And then he says there are eunuchs who have made themselves eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom. So a voluntary choice of celibacy. But then he also says, and there are eunuchs who have been so from birth.
Mm-hmm.
And I find that really suggestive. I mean, he doesn't elaborate. It's just, mm-hmm, kind of left there. But I find it really tantalizing. You know, Jesus is holding out a category of celibacy that is neither totally voluntary for the sake of the kingdom, nor totally, you know, constrained by someone outside of you, but something a little more subtle. Something, it's a kind of birth, something you're born into,
yep,
I think, as a result of living in a fallen world. And so his assumption is that's something that he has something to say about. The kingdom of God has something to say about that kind of celibacy.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm forgetting my train of thought. Can you remind me what the question is?
Do you think celibacy is a rare, special,
yeah,
calling,
okay,
or is it more common than we think?
Right. So I guess what I find myself wondering about often is, you know, do we sometimes not only think about marriage and the nuclear family in a confining way in many of our evangelical churches, do we also sometimes think about celibacy in a kind of narrow way? Mm-hmm. That it is this kind of special calling. It is this kind of thing that only a few select, you know, spiritually sturdy individuals should enter into. And insofar as we treat it that way, do we somehow overlook something like what Jesus is suggesting in Matthew 19. I mean, I had a fascinating conversation recently with my friend Eve Tushnet, who writes a lot about these things. I would encourage you to look at her writings on homosexuality and her Catholic faith. But, you know, one of the things she pointed out to me is you know, it may be actually a very few Catholic priests who would actually say, I am freely, positively called to celibacy. Yep. It's much more, for many of them, I know that I'm called to the priesthood, mm-hmm. and therefore celibacy is something that I am willing to take on, but it's not that I experience a kind of vivid, positive call to celibacy per se. And I think that, you know, kind of exploring that line of thought might open up our thinking about celibacy in the way that it isn't as rare as we think. Yeah.
All right. What can people do to help gay or LGBT people live celibate lives? What sustains you?
This is what I'm going to talk about tonight. Uh-huh. I mean, I think the book I'm working on that you mentioned, I feel for me, it was so powerfully energizing and liberating to realize that God might not simply be asking me to orient my life around a no to gay sex, which is what I'd often grown up thinking. You know, if you focus on what the Bible says about homosexuality, there, all those texts that mention it are negative texts. You know, don't lie with a man. Homosexuality is unnatural in Romans 1. It's all very negative. And I didn't think of it in a wider scope, that it might actually be that people who find themselves living with a certain condition that they feel like is out of step with what God wants for them, those very people may find a positive vocation concealed in their very weakness. And so for me, that's taken the form of realizing I am positively called not simply to say no to same-sex love, but to reinterpret mm-hmm. same-sex love. I am called to love men. You know, my friend Eve talks about one of the reasons she volunteers at a crisis pregnancy center is because she knows that she is called to love women. Mm-hmm. And it would be a sad thing if the only message she could hear from her church is, I'm called to say no to something without the positive calling to love. Yeah. So that's what I'll talk about tonight is, you know, I find a lot of hope in the fact that I am called to friendship. Mm-hmm. I am called to kinship relations. I mean, the brother-sister language saturates the New Testament. Mm-hmm. I'm called to inhabit that, to make that language my own. I'm called to love. That's where I find a lot of grace and hope these days.
And we'll tune in tonight for more.
Yes.
I think that's good. All right. You mentioned how some people require a change and that is the only, quote, cure. My question is it possible to switch from gay to straight? Has anyone experienced this, or are they just kidding and dealing with their feelings? Sorry.
Yeah. This is obviously a very live question for many of us in North American Christian circles right now with what's happened with Exodus International mm-hmm. recently. You'll hear more from Justin Lee about this next week. And by the way, please come hear Justin. He's terrific. I hope you'll really engage with him. He's a very dynamic speaker and he's a friend, so I hope people will come hear him. But I guess one of the things I would want to back up and do with a question like that is talk about, okay, the question seems to kind of assume the givenness of the gay straight language, and that's perfectly natural. I mean, it is just, it's language we've inherited. It's the language that we hear, you know, in the current discussion. So we kind of take it as given and work with it. But one of the things I think we're maybe invited to do by our Christian faith is think about the ways that language may not help us as well as help us to have a certain conversation. I mean, I talked a little bit earlier about how it actually helps me in certain ways, because by using words like gay or straight, I can usefully talk about how my questions differ from other people's questions and how my loneliness differs from other people's loneliness. But those are relatively recent terms. Mm-hmm. You know, homosexuality comes into our vocabulary in the 19th century. Yeah. The ancient world doesn't quite construe same-sex relations in those categories. It's very likely that we won't be doing so 100 years from now. Mm-hmm. You know, this is a kind of evolving discussion. So So that's the first thing I'd want to say. You know, is it possible for someone who's gay to become straight? Well, there's all kinds of relationships that we might choose to put ourselves into those labels. Mm-hmm. Now, probably what's behind the question is, can someone's desires, their exclusive attraction to men, in my case, can that go from being, you know, exclusive attraction to men to pretty much exclusive attraction to women? And that's a much more complicated question. And I mean, I think you could read a book like, you know, Ex-Gays question mark by Stan Jones and Mark Yarhouse, and they lay out, you know, some of the data. And what they found is they would prefer to talk not about change per se, but about, I think that their language is significant shifts on a continuum, mm-hmm. or something like that. That there do seem to be ways in which we experience sexuality as a kind of fluid thing. Lisa Diamond's book, Sexual Fluidity, is all about this in relation to women's sexualities. It seems to be not experienced in the same way by men. I guess part of what I want to say is you know, you can look at the data, you can come to your own conclusions about that. I don't feel any kind of need to resist or try to discount stories that I hear from my fellow Christians who say, I've experienced a pretty dramatic shift in my sexual attractions. Mm-hmm. I hear those stories. Mm-hmm. What I do feel like I want to resist is the kind of confident expectation, yeah. that if you just do it the way I did it, you too, mm-hmm. will experience a similar shift in your sexuality. Yeah. And that, I think, is part of the whole Exodus International conversation. That's part of why that's been such a difficult conversation to have, because when you adopt a slogan like change is possible, mm-hmm. there's very little room for nuance in that. Yeah. It can imply a kind of easy, ready access to this, and, yeah. and if you just try hard enough, this too can be your story.
And we come back to your point earlier where you said that there's sort of a universal model applied
That's
on
right.
every situation.
That's right,
that doesn't,
yeah.
That doesn't necessarily work.
Exactly.
All right, another one. How do you see your sexuality in the new heavens and new earth?
Well, we have something about Jesus from this in Matthew 22, and he tells us that, you know, in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage. Mm-hmm. That's very interesting. And again, it's one of those tantalizing sayings of Jesus that he doesn't elaborate on. You know, you sort of wish, go on for another chapter on that. But he just kind of leaves it there. I mean, I think what we are given, in particularly at the end of the book of Revelation, is a picture of the new heavens and the new earth as marital. Mm-hmm. The kind of final eschatological vision we're left is of a wedding feast.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're told in a text like Ephesians 5 that it's not a kind of immediate thing that Jesus has with each one of us individually. It's we corporately, as the redeemed church of God, finally purified, are like a radiant bride with him. We are the bride of Christ. And so I guess I would want to go in a way similar to the way C.S. Lewis goes in Mere Christianity, is that we catch a glimpse that our sexuality is caught up in something bigger, and becomes, our sexuality now points us to a kind of greater reality that will be true. What's difficult is trying to imagine that now.
Yeah.
And Lewis compares it to, you remember his famous analogy of you know, the I mean, it's kind of interesting that he puts this in Mere Christianity, but he says, you know, a boy, you know, asks, what is the greatest human pleasure? And, you know, here's the answer, sex. And he says, well, is eating chocolate part of it? Because in his limited, you know, framework, eating chocolate is the highest of human pleasures.
Mm-hmm.
And so he can't imagine that there could be a pleasure that might eclipse that pleasure.
Mm-hmm.
And so Lewis says that's the kind of position we're in when we think about sexuality in the new heavens and new earth. We know that we're heading for something that is going to not simply do away with the kind of sexuality we know now, but will be its fulfillment.
Mm-hmm.
But as soon as you start trying to articulate what that fulfillment would be and describe it,
yeah.
you run into trouble.
Yeah.
Makes sense. Yeah.
All right. Does your understanding rest on seeing male and female complementarity in Genesis as being prescriptive rather than descriptive? Do you want me to try that again?
Sure. Yeah.
Does your understanding rest on seeing male and female complementarity in Genesis as being prescriptive rather than descriptive?
So maybe the question means something like, we're given an image of male and female in marriage, sure, in Genesis 1 and 2, but perhaps that was simply a description of one instance, mm-hmm, and it's not meant to be a prescription for how marriage has to
correct
function the rest of the time. I think my understanding would be that it's prescriptive. It's, mm-hmm, it's, and I say that in part because of the way I see it taken up in the New Testament. Mm-hmm. I mean, just to give you a little glimpse into how I read Romans 1, for instance, where Paul is talking about, it's one of the only, well, it is the only place in Paul where he actually describes same-sex relations, and he describes them as an exchange. He's gone into this language of humans are those who were meant to worship an image that is other to them, but they've exchanged that image of the Creator for an image of the same. And so that leads then Paul into talking about same-sex relations. And so the way I would read that is that what is problematic for Paul about same-sex sexual relationships is that it doesn't involve this other, yeah, this image of complementary other. Mm-hmm. It's an image of the same. And so I see Paul kind of echoing Genesis a lot in Romans 1. So I do think he's thinking of that male-female otherness, that complementarity. Mm-hmm. And that's why he rejects it in Romans 1. That's the way I understand it right now.
Yeah. All right, a practical one. What advice do you have for someone with regards to coming out as a celibate gay Christian at a conservative church?
Yeah, that's a great question. and again, maybe I'll just share a little bit of my story. This took me a long time. Mm. I mean, I you know, I'm up here doing this right now, but 10 years ago, I would never have imagined, yeah, doing something like this. And I think what finally gave me the freedom to do it and the courage to do it is that I just had enough conversations with my fellow Christians along the way that were about blessing me and strengthening me and encouraging me rather than tearing me down.
Sure.
I mean, I received, and I know not everyone is this lucky. I mean, I've been really blessed in the church in many ways, and I know probably many of you in this room have been very deeply wounded by the church. And so I know this is not as easy for all of us, but, you know, I encountered, I think, thanks be to God, Christian after Christian in my journey who, you know, would take me by the shoulders and say, you did not choose this. This is not something that you are God is faulting you for. This is, you know, you're experiencing same-sex attraction in the way that anybody experiences their sexuality, which is as an unchosen, unlooked for reality that suddenly you wake up to one day. Mm-hmm. And God loves you in the midst of that. And then they explained, you know, the kind of the biblical meta-narrative, which, as I said earlier, I find persuasive, that there's a theology of creation, but there's also a theology of fall. Mm-hmm. So we're all created in the image of God, but we're all irreparably broken. And so when redemption comes, it doesn't affirm any of us. It doesn't simply include us as we are. It says, I'm going to take you and heal you and transform you to be something else. I mean, that is true. Straight, gay, any of us. That's, mm-hmm, the word of the gospel to us. And so I think I just had people in my life who not only said that to me and helped me understand it from Scripture, mm-hmm, but showed it to me in the way that, yeah, they loved me, in the way that they invited me into their lives. So I think the reason I'm sitting up here today is in part because I started writing a chapter of what became, you know, my book and shared it with two close friends, and then that became a third friend and a fourth friend, and finally someone said, you know, would you consider sharing this more widely? And so it was this kind of gradual thing, and so I guess my advice would be to start off with, I'll give you a phrase that a therapist of mine once gave me. He said, you need to find your circles of appropriate transparency. Coming out does not necessarily mean you stand up in front of your church and say, I'm gay, I'm celibate, and I need help. It may look instead like meeting with your close friend and his wife, or meeting with your two single friends, or meeting with, you know, that couple who led your Bible study. You know, there can be various circles, and these circles can be concentric, and not everybody in every one of the circles has to know everything that everybody else in the other circles are knowing. You know, that coming out can be, you know, the language of coming out implies one thing, but it can actually be many things, and it can be a journey. Yep. That might be what advice I would give.
Thank you. Does the speaker think that maybe at some time in the future he will be able to embrace the possibility of same-sex marriage for himself?
I will say that I am constantly reading and trying to hold my reading of Scripture before God with humility. So, I mean, I recently read, I noticed we have on the book table James Brownson's recent book, which, you know, is presenting a viewpoint that's different than mine. I read that book pretty carefully, and I mean, I'm always wanting to engage with things like that. I mentioned Eugene Rogers earlier. I read that book pretty prayerfully and carefully. So I partly want to answer by saying I'm committed to constantly wanting to place myself in situations with my fellow Christians where I'm forced to have this conversation again. Mm-hmm. I don't ever want my engagement with Scripture on this to simply be with people who already agree with me about it. I want to be in places like this where I know we have a diversity of viewpoints in the room. I came here expecting that, and I want that. Mm-hmm. I don't see how I would ever get there, if I'm speaking honestly. I realize I'm still quite young, and I still have a lot of growing to do and engaging with Scripture to do, but I find myself again and again kind of driven in a way that's not always welcome by what I believe Scripture is saying on this. And I think also, I think I'm coming to, and this is something I'm continuing to grapple with as an Anglican, coming to realize the ways in which my engagement of Scripture isn't finally what matters. Mm-hmm. In a certain sense, it doesn't matter if I come personally to a view of affirming gay marriage, because the church in which I've been confirmed hasn't seen its way clear to affirm that. So there's a sense in which I'm learning to recognize my pretty highly circumscribed role in the body of Christ. I mean, I'm not a priest. I'm not a bishop. So, you know, in a certain sense, it would change my life, I suppose, how I might try to live my life if I were to make this kind of shift. But I would never want to view that as my private choice. Yeah. I would want to view that as a conversation that I have with my church, and I discern the voice of God in my community with my church.
All right, a Calvin special, a two-part question.
Okay.
For many Christians, homosexuality is embedded in the sin portion of the biblical narrative and needs to be redeemed. How do you narrate the theme of homosexuality differently in the biblical narrative? That's part one. Do you want to wait and then get part two?
Sure, go ahead and give me part two.
Part two. As you follow your call, what do you need from the church? What do you sense is the church's vocation on this issue?
Okay, thank you. That was a good two-part question. I think about sin, kind of following St. Paul in a capital S sense and a lowercase s sense. And so I would say, in a capital S sense, I mean, the way Paul uses it, we are all under sin. We are all in Adam. We are all, every last one of us, participants in a fallen order. I mean, the world we see around us right now, the desires that each of us look inside and find, all of that is fallen. All of that falls under the banner of capital S, sin. Now, does that mean it's all lowercase s, actively willed sin? No. That's where I think my pastors were right to tell me, simply the fact that you have same-sex attraction, that is not your fault. That's not something God's going to hold you accountable for. That's the result of being born in the world that we're born into. So I would say it's the result of the fall, and in that sense I would put it under sin, but I wouldn't say we're actively culpable, any of us, for finding ourselves with the desires that we find ourselves with. So that then opens the question, you know, a whole range of things I would put in that category. I mean, the blindness of the man born blind in John chapter 9 I would put in that same category. The weakness that Paul talks about in 2 Corinthians, I would put in that category. All of those things are part of living in a world under capital S sin. So the question then becomes, you know, are all these aspects of our fallenness, is any of that able to be, in a sense, taken up by God and given a negative interpretation? Don't do this with your blindness. Don't do this with your bodily weakness. Don't do this with your fallen sexuality. But view your experience of fallenness as a calling toward the way in which God wants to lead you in the path of redemption. So for me, I would say my same-sex attraction is both, for me, a thorn in the flesh. I mean, I'm very willing to use that language of 2 Corinthians 12. It's something that I believe, if there had been no fall, I would not be gay. But there has been a fall, and I am gay. And so in that sense, I would put it under the weakness category. But I would also say my experience of homosexuality has been the way that God has taught me reliance on him in a way that I'm not sure I ever would have encountered otherwise. Yeah. It's a way that has pushed me into really serious, deep friendships with people that I'm not sure I ever would have gotten to. I mean, it caused me to want to be honest with others in a way that I might never have felt compelled to if I hadn't been gay. Yeah. So I experience it as this kind of simultaneous weakness and something in which I've experienced grace.
Yep.
So I guess, going to the second part of the question, in the midst of that kind of tension, what I feel like I need from the church is I need my church to say to me, we are not going to dishonor that tension you feel by trying to just automatically lead you to escape it, by yeah. pushing you toward a heterosexual marriage or by pushing you toward a same-sex marriage. We are going to recognize that celibacy throughout the Christian tradition, right from the beginning of Scripture, 1 Corinthians 7, Matthew 19, celibacy has a very honored place in Christian history. We are going to acknowledge that vocation as an honorable vocation. We're going to do everything we can to support you in it. And we're also going to make sure you know, as a celibate person, you are called to bring your gifts of love and service to our community. Mm-hmm. And we are called to love you and support you in the process. I mean, mm-hmm. that's what I hope. I mean, that sounds like a tall order, but it cashes out in very practical ways. I mean, like, I just loved the fact that my church in Durham, for instance, there were most of the dinner tables that I was invited to with my church friends, there was never an even number of chairs around the table. There was always an odd number of chairs. You know, that was just built into the DNA of that church, is single people were right there alongside young married couples with kids. You know, this is the life of the Christian community. That's where I find hope, is a church that says, we're going to support the celibate vocation, and we're going to support it by making sure that you're not just off in a singles group somewhere, but you are mm-hmm. deeply integrated into the life of this community.
Mm-hmm. All right. Let's see how many more I can do. A question asking, can you explain why exactly you are opposed to same-sex marriage? What led you to this decision? And it says, feel free to share any stories based on your experience.
Yeah. I guess the first thing I want to say to that is it's not because I don't feel that I'm saying no to same-sex marriage out of a sense of kind of internalized homophobia or something. Mm-hmm. You know, I actually really would desire it. It's not. I recognize that as I look at some same-sex couples, you know, that I know, it's not that it's just an inherently it always leads to observable harm or destruction. I don't find that. I find a lot of tenderness. I find a lot of virtues of patience and care for one another. So in many ways, this is I know why people are drawn to this. I'm drawn to this. This is a deeply compelling vision. I find myself though, part of a church community, part of a reading community of Scripture, and as I read about the creation of male and female in Genesis, and then as I come to the New Testament, hoping that that creation of male and female might be relativized or set aside, that's not what I find. I find it reaffirmed by Jesus in the gospel. I find it, as St. Paul writes in Ephesians 5, it's taken up to become an image of Christ in the church. So I find myself, you know, I guess constrained, you could say, compelled by my reading of Scripture in the church that I am part of, to say no to same-sex marriage. And that's not always, some days I feel like I'm really good at maybe articulating the church's stance on this, and I can explain it and defend it. Other days I feel like I'm just as confused by it as the next person. Yeah. And so I guess what it took to tell a story, you know, what my story then would look like is it's an ongoing choice for me to say, I feel more certain of the church that I belong to, and I feel more certain of the reading of Scripture that I've learned through being part of this church, than I feel of my own desire for same-sex marriage. I feel more certain that this life of tension is what God is calling me toward than I do this other kind of life. I guess, that's probably not very satisfying, but that's what I keep coming back to.
I think that's a very valid response. I think we'll have time for one more question. In the Roman Catholic tradition, celibacy is well understood as a valid vocation. How can we encourage other denominations to understand and embrace this?
That's a great question. One of the things I'm going to talk about tonight, I'll just give you a little teaser for it, is the need for churches to have some mechanism of public honoring for choices that need the support of the community. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is the reason we have bridesmaids and groomsmen at weddings, right? Mm-hmm. Is we're saying symbolically that if a couple is going to make promises till death do us part, that cannot just be about them. If they're ever going to have any hope of keeping those promises, they must be part of a community that will help them do it. And so built into our marriage rite as a church is this recognition that marriage is a community project. And I think we've got to reimagine ways in which celibacy is a community project. Mm-hmm. Next month, unfortunately, I'm not able to go. Next month, my parish in Pittsburgh, Church of the Ascension, there is a woman who will be taking a vow of celibacy. There will be a liturgical rite. She will take this vow in our church on a Saturday afternoon. And, you know, as many of us as can be there will be there. And she's saying with her, there will be friends who will stand up with her. And she will be saying with that kind of public vow that she's taking, I can't do this myself. Mm-hmm. I need this parish to come alongside me and help me in this. So maybe just one brief answer, and we'll have time to talk more about this tonight, but one brief answer would be, could we begin to imagine ways in which celibacy is not simply about the vowed religious life, as it is in the Roman Catholic Church, but there's what I've started calling, there can be such a thing as parish celibacy. Mm-hmm. Not simply monastic celibacy, but parish celibacy. Mm-hmm. And what would it take for us to begin to imagine concrete ways for that kind of life to flourish? You know, does it look like living together with others and in intentional Christian community? Does it look like finding ways to get your priest to let you do what this woman will be doing next month at my church? You know, I don't know. We could probably think of 100 different answers to that question, but that's the direction we've got to move. And let me just maybe this book is already on the book table. I don't know, but let me just mention the book Singled Out by Christine Cologne and Bonnie Field. This is a book that came out 4 or 5 years ago. I just think it's chock full of good thinking about this very question. How do we, the subtitle is something like Why Celibacy Must Be Reinvented for Today's Church. And it's a book that's largely written to evangelical Protestants by two evangelical Protestants. And they're trying to say, you know, how can we learn from the riches of the Catholic tradition in embodying a new way in evangelicalism. So I highly recommend that book. It helped me a lot when I read it.
Thank you. Well, thank you to everybody who submitted excellent questions. I think we've done a good job on that. And thank you so much to Wesley Hill for taking the time to come and speak with us.
Thank you. Thank you.
Again, there are refreshments outside. There's a book table outside. Wesley Hill will be available for book signings if you want to talk with him. And then this evening at 7 o'clock in here.